What's up, everyone? Welcome to another week of What You're Missing. Just a couple updates about the channel. You're going to be seeing things change both this week and just over time in general because I'm trying to get better at it and I'm going to do some promoting and trying to get this out there a little bit more. And so I'm going to try to align titles and I don't know, thumbnail images or whatever else. So I'm looking into things, I'm learning, and things will change a little bit here and there. So if you see something that's different and you really don't like it, let me know and I will take it into consideration and possibly not make whatever change I had just made. So I'm relying on you. So that brings us to this week's news, or I guess last week's news. I do this every goddamn week. Last week's news. That's what we're here for, because I don't know this week's news yet because it's Monday and that's how this works. So bear with me. All right, so jumping right into it, this isn't exactly video game related, but I saw the article and I thought it was really interesting, or at least worth reading, so I'm going to share it with you. So Ghostbusters 3 was in development, and the character, the actor that played Egon, passed away last year, and so it's been up in the air and possibly even canned, and so there was talk of a reboot of Ghostbusters, and I saw a report in this article that said that they were actually really seriously considering making the cast of Ghostbusters and all of the leads women. So it would be female Ghostbusters in the reboot, which I think is really cool. I think it would make for, I don't know, it'd make it really interesting and sort of a different take on a favorite of many, many people who were brought up and raised in the 80s and the 90s. So I think that's really cool. Look for that and we'll keep our eyes peeled. One of the things that I've talked about in the past is shared creativity, and I've seen a lot of videos over the last few weeks of movies that people have recreated or scenes from movies that people have recreated using GTA 5, and the article that I saw this week was talking about that a little bit, that people really share things that they've done on a creative level in games, and that they're sharing stunts that they've done. They're sharing, like I said, scenes from movies that they've reenacted, or a lot of games other than GTA 5. You've seen in Second Son people using like a photograph or a screenshot mechanism to share the beauty of the world that they're in. That's also apparently possible and available for people to use in The Last of Us Remastered Edition on PS4. So that's really cool. And so this article touched on that, and it was highlighting and commenting on the fact that people share the creative side of these games and the tools that they're given to do that. And then it was really cool that The Last of Us allowed them, you know, that added that functionality. And it highlighted the interesting fact that people are not sharing violence, that even in games like GTA 5, which are known kind of all over the web, the interweb, as, you know, extremely violent games, and that's usually the type of game, if not specifically the game, that gets the finger pointed at it whenever there's violence in schools or just in general, that, you know, people are learning to kill hookers and, you know, go on mass shooting sprees and all kinds of horrible things in this game. But when it comes right down to it, what people are sharing and what people are sort of reveling in those games has absolutely nothing to do with violence, but, you know, riding a bike off the top of a skyscraper and riding down the end. And so, I mean, just all sorts of random stuff. And I think it's really cool that at least some portion of the media or journalism or journalists are highlighting what is actually being done with these games and not what conservative right wing or just maybe not even politically minded, but that ignorant people are trying to say that this is the reason for, you know, violence in our society. I hate to say it, but violence is a part of our society and has been for as long as we've walked upright. So I don't think video games are the start of that. But anyway, it was really cool to see that, and it was a really interesting sort of commentary that was made on, you know, what people choose to share, and hopefully that a lot of games that come out in the future will have this ability to be or to express creativity in some way, whether it's framing and taking pictures within the game to sort of create your own narrative and your own story, or even something as sort of open-ended as what GTA 5 allows, or Minecraft, or any of these other more creative games. So that's really cool. Next up is there are a couple items on the list for PlayStation specific. Those of you who are new I have PlayStations. I've got a PlayStation 4, 3, and a PS Vita, and but I do most of my gaming on my PC. But I've never owned an Xbox, so I don't hate Xbox. I'll get to that in a minute, but I've never been part of that ecosystem. But so the two news items that I've got here, PlayStation Now hit public beta last week, and they're sort of opening up the servers to let everybody come out and or come on and try their system, try and load their servers. And also, I think most importantly, it's giving them a testing ground for the pricing schedule or pricing mechanism that they're using. I think currently it's $2.99 for 4 hours of a rental of a game, $5.99 for 7 days, and then it just doubles for everything after that. So it's like 7 days is a week, right? So if you want it for a month, it's $15. If you want it for 3 months, it's 30, or maybe it's, I don't know. Anyway, all the numbers are out there. They're pretty high. And what I heard somebody say, I listened to the podcast that IGN puts out, the Beyond podcast. They're very PlayStation centric. And one of the things that they said there, and I've got another comment from that podcast as well later on, but one of the things that they said is that PlayStation Now needs to figure out and find its stride in a subscription model, much the same way that Netflix did. And that once they obtain that it's really, maybe it was a news article that I read that in, not the podcast. Anyway, that's a very astute observation, and that if they, PlayStation and Sony in general, have come out and they've said that they have plans to implement a subscription model, but they don't have it out yet and they don't know exactly what it would look like. I think there's a lot of turmoil behind the scenes as far as who's controlling what regions it's going to be available in, and what regions it's going to, cost what, and who controls the pricing and all of that. So it's in public beta. They're testing out the pricing, and they've been very open in saying that what pricing you see now is not written in stone. Don't, we're open to your feedback. Please tell us what you think, and it will change. So that's good to hear. And yeah, here's hoping that they do find a good subscription model, and that it opens up sort of their whole ecosystem to a much broader audience. Because once you're, the way it works a lot of times is once you get into a certain generation of console, you have to kiss goodbye all of the previous generation's games. PlayStation, some of the more popular PlayStation 2 games made the jump to PlayStation 3, and likewise, some of the more popular PlayStation 3 games have made the jump to PlayStation 4, and they will probably continue to do that. But in lieu of that, or in addition to that anyway, PlayStation Now would give like whole libraries of games, or give you access to them on your PlayStation 4. And so you wouldn't have to rebuy games, or you wouldn't have to feel like you missed out on, a whole bunch of games that were in the previous generation that were great games that your friends played and that you've heard about, but just aren't being remastered for the, anyway. So PlayStation Now beta is open to the public now. Go out, check it out, test it. It's largely dependent upon your internet speeds and the congestion of your network. So there are a couple articles out there if you want to go and look and see kind of what the requirements are. And yeah, it sounds like things are going well though. So if this is something you're looking forward to, go check it out. Also on the PlayStation news item list, apparently in the last quarter, which is considered Q1 in this industry. So the first quarter starts in April, and then the fourth quarter ends in March. So Q1 of 2014, or I guess it's fiscal year 2015, PlayStation outsold Xbox 3-1, which is really, really substantial. That said, it's worth noting that Xbox is still selling well, especially when compared to how it sold with the 360 and previous generations, that it's still doing well in the market. And even though I like PlayStation, and I of course like to see PlayStation do well and beat Xbox, you don't ever want to see, or I don't ever want to see, competition fall out of the market. Like, I know a lot of people love Nintendo and that whole ecosystem of games, but they're really struggling, and their absence in the market has an effect on Sony and Microsoft, in that there is a lot less pressure on both of them, in the way that there was a lot of pressure on them when the original Wii came out and was doing so well. So Unfortunately, for Microsoft, they're not doing anywhere near as well as PlayStation is. They're probably taking cues and changing their strategy on the fly, as you can see with them dropping the Kinect and trying to change other things there and reprioritize their whole strategy. So we'll see what goes from there, but well done, PlayStation. That's really a remarkable feat. So keep up the good work. While we're talking about Nintendo, in the last quarter or in Q1, they apparently lost $97 million in spite of Mario Kart 8's launch and massive sales. So they, of course, have explanations as to why that is, and yeah, they need more Wii U's out in the market. It doesn't matter how great the game is, whatever game that may come out, if there's only 13 units that have been sold, if you get 100% market saturation, you make 13 sales. So they're in dire straits right now. And last I heard, I want to say that they were talking about coming out with yet another generation beyond the Wii U to kind of like just scrap what they've done and move into something that's much more up to date. I heard stories and read articles about people trying to transfer their Wii games and saves to the Wii U and how it's just such this arduous process of like hour or two of transferring files on a little thing and trying to bring it over. And it's not cloud-based like Xbox or PlayStation, and it's just this archaic infrastructure and network, and it's terrible. So hopefully, if they are working on a new generation of console for themselves, it will like work network connectivity and cloud storage and all kinds of things into it. They've got a long way to go if they don't have server farms built up for it already, but here's hoping they pick up their lost ground. On to another topic. I know we talk a lot about girls with games or girls gaming or the role of women in the video game industry or just the role of women in general. It's something that's relatively important to me and increasingly, I think, important to at least our country, if not the world at large. And so that said, there was a convention or a summer camp that was held in various places all over the world, called Girls Make Games. And it was an all-girls game development summer camp that brought, I think, 2 to 3 dozen girls between the ages of 10 and 16 in and taught them sort of the business and the act of developing and making a game. And so through this 3-week camp, they would make a game. And one of the games that came out of that is actually on Kickstarter for looking for funding and trying to get out in the market. And so I'll post a link to the article that I read about this whole thing. It's very interesting and it's worth a read for a couple reasons, not the least of which being that it'll give you a link to go and support their game. Their original Kickstarter goal was $10,000 and their stretch goal was $15,000. And with the amount of people on the internet who are willing to give money to video game developers, I don't think they're going to have any trouble meeting that goal. If you would like to contribute, you can follow a link within the link and so on and so forth. But so check out the link. Look at some of the things that the girls said about kind of how their perspective of not only the gaming industry changed, or at least how they started to view it, but also the world at large and how they were treated merely because they were girls. One girl said specifically, "People say things, you stop noticing that it's derogatory." And I think this camp brought back the awareness of that. And so when she went home, she said that, you know, her brother, now granted, you know, she's a teenager or a kid, and her brother is probably also a kid and prone to saying things that are mean and, you know, as kids are. But that when she went home, he said something to her that was derogatory or mean about her being a girl. And normally she said that she would have just, you know, just taken it in stride and not thought about it again, but that because of being in this camp and being surrounded by women and you know, kind of making games that they were interested in instead of, you know, the dreck that the gaming industry is making and saying that, you know, or marketing to them, that, you know, when she heard the things that he was saying, that she actually stopped and kind of thought about it. Now, they didn't talk about her arguing with her brother, but it was just this realization that it's so ingrained in society and our culture that these things are said and that's a normal and natural thing that it almost should be accepted. And I think it's really cool that camps like this are going on and that people's eyes are being opened a little bit not only in the gaming industry, but that just, you know, women's roles in society and culture definitely need to change. And, you know, this is a great vehicle for that. So check out the link. I'll post it down in the description below. And it's a good read. Last up, last Monday, we've got three lasts here. So this is last up, last Monday. There was a Last of Us live show that was being broadcast on, I want to say YouTube. But anyway, I'll post a link. You can see the video there in its entirety. It was an hour and a half. And what they did is they got all the voice actors for the main characters in the game onto a stage. And they literally kind of, they did a stage reproduction of all of the cutscenes from the game. And Neil Druckmann came out between scenes and sort of gave some context to what had happened or where, you know, what was going on from one scene to the next. They had musical acts. And it was, if you've played the game, seeing, it was such an abstract thing that you know, they, none of them had props, and these weren't the actual, like, you know, you played the game, you saw the people that the developers had created with their art, but you're actually seeing actors who are not those people that you've seen. But the emotional connection that I still felt, and the just the visceral reaction that I had in seeing these scenes that I, you know, hadn't seen or could only really remember from a year ago when I played, it was really powerful. So I'll post the link in the description. You really should go check it out. I'm not saying you should watch all an hour and a half of it. If you do, that's fantastic, and I think you may enjoy it. Set aside some time, turn off music and like the distractions, and really, really get into it. That said, I talked about the Beyond podcast that IGN does. Go listen to them. They've got some really interesting insights and comments on this as well. And Colin Moriarty on there, he's a rather serious fellow a lot of the times, but very smart, very sharp. And he made this comment because a lot of times people write into them and talk about how there are no games for the PS4 and how indie games are shit and they're not real games and that, you know, we need more real games. And he's always making the argument that these indie games, a lot of them are fantastic games, and that just because something isn't a AAA title doesn't mean that it should be disregarded or isn't a real game. Obviously, not every game is for everybody, so maybe some people just don't like indie games. But his comment with regard to this Last of Us live production was that this is one of the things that sets apart a AAA title and a AAA studio, is that you're not going to see smaller studios and developers do this because they're not able to. They're not going to have the resources to put on a live show and to bring out the director and the creative, you know, teams and all these musicians. And to put on a show like this is something that really only a AAA studio could do. And so there's definitely a place in the market for large developers and large studios like this, but not to disregard indies and smaller studios and developers. So I thought that was a really astute comment and observation. So it was in last week's Beyond podcast. Go check it out. That's worth it. I'll put the link to the video that I found on Polygon of the entire show. It's worth a watch. And yeah, and that's it. So thanks for watching this week. Go ahead and hit the subscribe button. If you have any thoughts on ways that I can better promote this video and what I'm doing here, by all means, contact me. I'd love more interaction from you and or your friends and or anybody. So bring it on. Come at me, bro. And yeah, that's all I got. So I'll see you tomorrow. Tell your friends and have a good day.